we're on the floor of AMA 2016. The Academy of Model Aeronautics is the birthplace to many of us who eventually went on to have careers in aviation. But some of the coolest things are seen in connection with AMA, and I'm so glad to see NASA here, because not just for what you're doing, but for all the kids you're inspiring. That's maybe the biggest responsibility you have.
Oh, by far. We've done most of the work with the Prandtl project, preliminary research aerodynamic design to lower drag. We always drop the last D off, but it is Prandtl, and that's in honor of Ludwig Prandtl, and we've done most of that with interns. So it is kids, it's students, it's student-driven.
What is the mission statement, if you will, for this program? What do you hope to get out of it, and what are you learning?
This is a 23-year thought experiment for me. But it's only been in the last 5 years or so that big pieces started coming in, and all of a sudden, all of the pieces start fitting together. Originally, when we put this together, we knew that there were some efficiency gains. And the big one, of course, is what is the minimum induced drag for a wing? Now, the original solution that everybody always thinks of is what's the minimum induced drag for a wing span? And this is the problem that's in all the textbooks. And it was originally formulated and solved by Prandtl himself in 1920. But no one ever looks at his 1933 paper where he says, that answer is correct, but it's not complete. And he says, what you need to consider is the structure as well. And if you look at the way birds are put together, they are put together differently, and they don't use the elliptical span load of 1920. They do something that's much more bell-shaped, as Horton used to call it. Mm-hmm. And so Prandtl's solution is purely analytic, and it is the correct answer. Horton was an approximation to that. There's 12.5% increase in efficiency with Prandtl, just on the wing alone. So this is like double what Whitcomb did with winglets. Okay, so now, in addition, you get the tail, the empennage and the tail. That's 30% of your drag. You get to get rid of that also. And now you can control roll and yaw correctly without any sort of drag-making device or anything necessary hanging out in the
breeze. How so?
So it turns out that, think about Whitcomb for a moment, okay, with his winglets. If you actually cut the winglet at the base and put a load cell there, you would discover that the winglet's actually pushing forward.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So if you imagine that the winglet were folded out flat, and then you put the control surface for roll out on the winglet.
Okay.
Now you're developing thrust. So instead of downwash for the wing and the lift rotated aft, you're operating outside of the tip vortex.
Okay.
And the lift is actually rotated forward because of the upwash. And so now when you increase the lift, you increase the thrust, and you roll and you yaw in the correct direction.
So yaw becomes propulsive.
Yaw becomes propulsive.
Whoa, 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 whoa. That's...
Yes.
I mean, yaw, everything I've ever learned, yaw is a drag.
Yaw is
always a drag.
Adverse yaw, right? I can remember my instructor when I was learning to fly sailplanes whacking me in the back of the head with a roll of paper because I wasn't using enough rudder pedal. Now, it turns out you don't need rudder pedal. That's what we've done. You don't need rudder pedals.
Wow.
And improved efficiency all the way across the board. I can beat a conventional wing with a tail by about 50%.
There's a difference between charting a steady course and pushing for the ceiling. And for nearly a century, Hartzell Propeller has been defining that difference. It's in our passion for engineering and research and our dedication to testing the limits of performance. We are built on honor. We are Hartzell Propeller.
Redbird is quickly becoming the industry standard for flight training. Since Redbird introduced its revolutionary FMX in 2007, colleges, universities, and flight training operations around the world have integrated Redbird products into their curriculum. It's time to discover what Redbird can do for you. Join the migration.
Obviously, this is a concept vehicle. How do you operate it? What have you done to build real-time data with this kind of vehicle?
So the initial work that we've done has been primarily on, can you get roll and yaw in the correct direction, and how much? And can you predict that? So we did analytical models, and I came up with how much CN delta A, right? Mm-hmm. So it's coefficient of yaw due to aileron deflection. So aileron deflection, and then how much yaw do you get out of that? and I predicted what that value would be for this configuration. And then we actually went out and we tried to extract that data from in-flight flight research parameter identification to get those aerodynamic coefficients. And we've done it three times now with three different groups of interns, and their data matches very closely to the original one that I predicted for this particular configuration.
In the proper mix, you get the perfectly coordinated turn.
You get a perfectly coordinated turn.
Wait a second, come on. You're making it too easy. You're going to eventually put pilots out of work. Shame on you.
And there's a bunch of other things that all of a sudden cascade. You've never seen a bird with a spin problem. They don't have a stall spin problem. Why is that? We know the answer now. And this is that answer. This is what birds do. And this is something that we haven't figured out yet. And until we figure this out, by the way, all sorts of things fall apart when you do this. MAC no longer has meaning in the traditional sense.
Okay.
And so we have arguments amongst our group, in our team, about what does MAC mean now? And so we still use that as a point of reference for what we're doing. But in reality, it doesn't have the meaning that it did when you have constant downwash, and if you use an elliptical planform, you end up with constant CL, and there, MAC has real meaning, based purely on geometry of the planform. But now, because it no longer does that, it doesn't. And so RCG is very, very far forward compared to what people are used to seeing. But we have no trim in order to take care of that CG being at the 12% point.
Now certified Aspen Avionics single band ADS-B ATX-100 and ATX-100G transceivers are the next gen ADS-B solution that provides the features pilots need while keeping flyaway costs low. Check it out now at aspenavionics.com. Concorde's recombinant gas RG series sealed battery technology produces a high performance battery with the advantages of being pre-tested and fully charged at the factory. Find out more about Concorde's entire line of batteries at www.concordbattery.com. Concorde, the heart of your aircraft.
I see this in the far future as being blended wing bodies, blended wing body flying wings without any vertical surfaces at all. And you end up with this more bell-shaped lift distribution, and that forces you to do things. We've always had like load alleviation. You want to put the engines further out on the wing for load alleviation. Well, if you don't actually develop the lift out there, you want to put the engines closer to centerline.
Okay.
And so that reduces your engine out thrust moment. And so now it becomes much easier to control with simple drag devices out at the very tips. So there's a bunch of things that we need to learn. There is still the problem of the 200-foot airport gate spacing. So it turns out that that's about a 767 size airplane. So it's a wide body twin aisle, and you're talking about 300 people.
Yeah, but we're building 380 gates already, so it shouldn't be that much of a problem.
It maybe not.
Yeah.
Until we get to that point that we do this a bunch of times, and we understand this as well as we understand the elliptical, I don't see how you can rationally argue one or the other. I have some feelings about that. There are some cases where clearly you have a span limitation. And in that case, the 1920 answer is correct. Mm-hmm. But if you really don't have a span limitation, you should look a lot more like this. One of the places that we're trying to go, actually right at the moment, we have a proposal to fly one of these on Mars. When Curiosity went to Mars, it had 57 kilograms of tungsten ballast on board to trim the vehicle during the cruise. Once they got to Mars, the ballast got ejected. I want my little wing to be one of those kilograms of ballast that gets ejected. And we'd love to pop out at Mars at about 12,000 feet above the surface and then fly down, glide down, land, and get close-up video of the surface, perhaps overfly some of the landing sites where humans will be, or perhaps even get scientific data of what's the pressure and temperature profile of the atmosphere above Mars. No one's ever done that. No one's done that.
This is really cool stuff.
I want to be that guy.
Sir, you've been a joy to talk to. I look forward to catch up with you down the line, and thanks so much for your time.
All right, Jim. Take care.